for the beautiful recitation of the Holy Quran. It's always a pleasure to listen to the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And these words that we listen to were revealed unto a man that we know as our prophet and our final messenger, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. So with that, we begin today's program, and that is celebrating the birth of the prophet of mankind, the blessed prophet that we have been brought up to love and respect and learn from. So with that, good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and I'm Ali, your MC for tonight, and together we shall be celebrating the birth of the prophet of mankind, and that is none other than Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. And with that, aloud, salawat ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. Tonight's festivities will incorporate a range of speakers from around England, a range of poetry, nasheeds, and obviously good food to fill our bellies. And this food is from a place that I've been told far, far away, from a land called India, and hopefully we'll enjoy this beautiful food and make the most out of the birthday of the Prophet. And it's once a year that we get to enjoy as a big family of Muslims together and celebrate the love of mankind, and that comes from our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. Salawat. Now you may be thinking why I'm constantly dropping the salawats. That's because it's a beautiful chance to actually praise the Prophet and send blessings upon the Prophet, as God himself in the Quran has stated, إِنَّ اللَّهُ وَمَلَائِكَةُ يُصَلُّونَ عَلَى النَّبِيِّ يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا صَلُّوا عَلَيْهِ وَسَلِّمُوا تَسْلِيمًا. And now I'd like to invite our first poet, Tahir Adil, to come to the stage and enlighten this event and praise the man that we know and praise God's messenger and open the skies up with the beautiful praise of the Prophet and the chanting that he will give. And obviously, and each time I say a salawat, I'd like the salawats to get louder and louder. So before I invite him to the front, I'd like you all to say and praise the Prophet with a loud salawat ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
من صلى على محمد وآل محمد. السلام عليكم brothers and sisters. First, I'd like to thank the organizers for inviting me and thanking them for a wonderful, wonderful event. Looking forward to the food, but first, my piece of poetry is entitled The Orbit of Devotion. At first it seemed like a normal day, just like today. At first it seemed like a normal day, just like today, where... Allah, I'm sorry. At first it seemed like a normal day, just like today, where us men lay unaware of the canopies of shimmering constellations written above us as expressions of wonder, unaware of the layers that paint the sky, or the curves of, or the tears, or the warmth of a tear inside the curves of an eye. It seemed like a normal day, just like today, where the sun would arise in no dramatic form compared to some days where it rises dressed like a tropical bird, bright colors and hues the norm, and some days it rises to a stormy sky and chooses never to show its face. But it always arises in one form or another over the same ungrateful human race. And under it, countries rise and fall. Lovers laugh and cry. Under it, new souls are born and older ones struggle and die. And wrapped through it all with tentacles deep is joy, grief, and pain. As the sun arises differently each day, but the world remains the same. But that day was very different. That day was very different. There were no three wise men to follow a star and call it Christmas. Just another day based in the heart of backward Arabia. A child, a boy was born, and 1,000 daughters entered the grave premature. A child was born from the lineage of Ishmael, and no man batted an eyelid nor realized how the next 60 years will revolutionize what we all did. This dawn, noon, and maghrib, how the world knelt before God with every rise and sunset, and for the first time, the humans participated in its orbit, the orbit of devotion, 5 times a day while the earth prayed on its axis, spinning with the planets on a gravitational mattress, while the moon thanks its Lord every 27 days in practice for the presence of the infant we know as Ahmed. Born into a land where hearts are as stubborn as the ground they walked on. His birth was an unpredicted entrance and ark to save those drowning in a sea of ignorance. In a poetic world, he brought forth words that made poets seem illiterate and shackled an empire of racism when he declared Bilal his mu'adhin, reverberating in Rome and Byzantium, the child of Arabia has turned deserts into water. Woman, we're now no longer dead daughters under 6 feet of rubble or unappreciated mothers, with Khadija as his backbone and his legacy, and Fatima, the mother of her father, in all its honor, wife, daughter, and scholar. Raising moon upon moon until 12 orbits intertwined like the double helix of man, starting and ending with Muhammad. Now back to the first. His birth was an unpredicted entrance. His birth was an eclipse, neither solar nor lunar. His vision was ahead of his time. No man had seen it greater. While the world is still getting to grips, understanding the man that had none but God as his ruler, healing men in the art of sister and brother. But all this talk collapsed when we mortal men destroyed his death wish, the fruition of his ummah. A community designed and based on the designs of nature, where every deed was not based on color or stature. Just like the sizes of the planets did not determine who is greater in the eyes of the creator who designed them such as proof of a maker. So in the end, man murmured the words but forgot the lessons. We are the most intelligent species on the planet, forever exploring the outside despite the flaws on our insides, writing more books than we could ever read, building beautiful but unsustainable civilizations separated only by water, rivers, oceans, and seas. Water, the 60% of the body, the 72% of the surface of the globe. 2130, and we made from water every living thing. So what are we but beings that have unlearned what comes naturally to us? Polarized by everything man has created, minds that do not flow outside the closed lakes of ignorance, born and stagnated within our race, class, and ideologies, hiding behind faces that refuse to unmask and descend. For the first act of disobedience was Iblis and his failure to prostrate before Adam. And soon man followed in his disrespect for his fellow men. Who are we but raindrops with no knowledge of destinations? Souls dropped by clouds over foreign lands, unaware of where we land and to whom we are born. But what is clear is just like water and just like the overlapping skin on your palms that fold perfectly with each repetition, breaking down to our knees 5 times a day like tides, controlled by the gravitational force of submission, leaving our hearts and mind parallel to the ground, stationed in the lowest position, and eyes facing nothing but the darkness of the ground where color is meaningless and status offering no elevated position. And then we whisper to the ground and we whisper to the sky and the world that surrounds, Allahumma salli ala Muhammad, for introducing us to the orbit of devotion. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
Thank you very much for that beautiful poetry, Brother Tahir. But before we continue, there's a car outside with the headlight switched on, and the number plate is HN64UPF, a black car. If you want to save your battery, then please turn your lights off. Thank you very much. Salawat ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. So as you know, these events would not be possible without partners, sponsors, and obviously the ABSOC, the Ahlul Bayt Society of the University, is working hard together to organize such beautiful events that when we can all sit together and have perfect networking opportunities to form new bonds and to renew old bonds, to make new friends and to see new faces, and to all sign the signatures on the papers that we are all brought and we are all one family. So with that, I'd like to call upon SafeerTV, our partner in Milad Nabi, and allow them to come forward, speak a few words of what they do, what their mission is, and how they serve Prophet, and how they serve humanity, and how they educate us humans for the benefit of our lives. I'd like to call on Sister Sara Bukhari. Thank you very much. Salawat ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad.
This way. Okay, thank you. Dear respected scholars, brothers and sisters, salamu alaikum. Just to introduce myself, my name is Sara Bukhari. I'm a producer and a presenter at the channel SafeerTV. Some of you may or may not have heard of this channel, but we are a brand new broadcasting channel that's launched on Sky just last year on the 15th of Sha'ban in order to propagate the message of Ahl Bayt al-Islam. How is it that we do this? Some of you may or may not know, but Safeer means ambassador. When we say ambassador, a lot of people recall the Cabinet Akil, and they say he was a Safeer of Hussein. However, as many of us know, times throughout the ages, no matter where we belong, whether now or 1400 years ago, each and every one of us has the capacity to be an ambassador for the Ahl Bayt al-Islam. And this is our vision, this is our to unite our efforts collectively as Muslims from different backgrounds, different ages, different nationalities, and join in this message of propagating the message of the Ahl Bayt al-Islam. I'm going to take this opportunity just to discuss some of the projects that we're doing currently, some of the ways in which you can get involved, some of the things that we're doing behind the scenes to ensure that this message of the Ahl Bayt al-Islam is propagated to all corners of the globe. As some of you know, the very Prophet that we're celebrating today, unfortunately recently was targeted within the media, across worldwide media, whether that's here in Europe, in the United States. And this Prophet is somebody that, as we all know, has a message of peace, loving, is all-embracing, is fair, is just, is a man that each and every one of us believe is beloved to us because of the message that he stood for. And therefore, we wish to be Safeers of this very Prophet that we're here today to serve and also celebrate. The motto of Safeer TV is Together We Serve, and we adapt this motto depending on the occasion. Today we'd like to say Together We Celebrate, and we'd like to invite each and every one of you to celebrate with us in this message. Safeer TV ranges in their media from child documentaries, entertainment, to documentaries covering places all over the world, also media, women's productions, and also productions that enhance entertainment for Muslims in a way that's very moderate and something that everybody can enjoy, no matter age or background. And therefore, we'd like to invite you, whether you're a student and would like a student internship over the summer, or you're somebody who has a production idea, or you're generally passionate about the media and you'd like some part-time work, we at SafeerTV believe that together we do serve this message of the Ahlul Bayt, and therefore this cause is something I believe in passionately about, because it's something that each and every one of us, no matter what our talents are, can get involved in. If you're a writer, if you're somebody who knows how to produce media, if you enjoy reciting, each and every one of us have a talent that we can use, and we can contribute together for this message. And therefore, if you do have a certain talent you'd like to put forward, you have a resource that you'd like to contribute towards the channel, we openly welcome you with open arms and would gladly look forward to hearing from you. We have a stall, some of you have already visited us, it's in the room behind. So if after the program you'd like to come and visit us and ask us any questions, we're also doing a raffle and we'd gladly look forward to seeing you. That's all from me, and inshallah, together we celebrate together. And congratulations on the birth of the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. Wa alaikum salam.
Thank you very much. And as the sister has mentioned, there are stalls at the back, so please take your time when eating dinner or whenever you're free to go visit these stalls and learn more about the sponsors. For example, Noor Orphans, Lady Sumaya Trust, obviously ABSOC and SafeerTV. SafeerTV is doing a raffle, and the prize is a rug from the shrine of Imam Ali alayhi salam from Najaf. So if you're lucky, you could be walking away tonight and going home with a beautiful rug from the shrine of Imam Ali. And ABSOC is also doing a raffle, and the prize for that is this beautiful painting with God's name, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, written on it with a beautiful background. And obviously, this is something that I want to walk away with, so I think I'm going to buy two. So if anyone wants to buy two or more, please head to the back and buy raffles. Thank you very much. Now the starters are coming out, so enjoy yourselves, and we're going to have a beautiful nasheed recited from the famous and most respected Shabbir and Abbas Tejani. I'd like to call you forward with a very, very loud salawat ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad.
Our respected scholar, distinguished guests, my brothers, sisters, elders, children, assalamu alaikum jameen wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Firstly, I'd like to congratulate you, or rather we'd like to congratulate you all on this event, on this celebration of the birth of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. Glad we got the mic working. Just wanted to thank the organizers of this event for extending their invitation to us to come and perform. So a couple of things. Firstly, I would like to just tell you all, let you all know that unfortunately we're both a little bit under the weather, so advanced apologies if the performance is not up to scratch. Secondly, we actually don't have anything prepared for today, so we've got two options for you. You can give us requests or we'll improvise, so it's up to you. So we'll start off. Can we have a loud salawat, please? Any requests? No? Okay, so let's start. You gave us parity of life. You took away the sleepless night. You gave us hope, healed our souls, and took us all towards new heights. We want to follow your footsteps. You are our only saving grace. You are the closest to Allah. In your heart we all want a place. So give us all a helping hand, because you are the greatest man. You are Muhammad sallallahu. You are Muhammad sallallahu. You are Muhammad sallallahu. You are Muhammad sallallahu. You are Muhammad sallallahu.
You are the brightness of the day, the peace and harmony of night. You shine out like a glowing star, the one that showers the world with light. You showed us it is essential to be truthful and to be fair. You showed us how to live our lives. You showed us how to love and care. A man like you will never find. You own our hearts, you own our minds. You are Muhammad sallallahu. You are Muhammad sallallahu. You are Everyone together, we're here celebrating. You are Muhammad sallallahu. You are Muhammad sallallahu.
You are a teacher, our guide. You are the meaning of our lives. We'll always keep you in our hearts until the moment that we die. You are the start, you are the end. The universe is in your hands. You own the planets and the skies. You own the smallest grain of sand.
Muhammad, 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 Muhammad,
oh, Muhammad, Muhammad, oh,
Muhammad, Muhammad,
oh, you are Muhammad,
once had a teacher, the teacher of teachers. He changed the world for the better and made us better creatures. Oh Allah, we've shamed ourselves, we've strayed from Al-Mu'allim. Surely we've wronged ourselves. What will we say in front of him? Oh, Muallim. He was Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Muhammad, mercy upon mankind, teacher of all mankind.
He prayed whilst others slept, whilst others ate, he'd fast. Whilst they laughed, he wept until he breathed his last. His only wish was for us to be amongst the ones who prosper. Ya Muallim, peace be upon you. Truly you are
are a teacher. Oh, Muallim. He was Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Muhammad, mercy upon mankind. He was Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Muhammad, mercy upon mankind. Teacher of all mankind, leader of all mankind, savior of all mankind, Abul Qasim. Abul Qasim, Ya Habibi, Ya Muhammad, Ya Shafi, Ya Muhammad, Khairu Khalqillahi Muhammad, Ya Mustafa, Ya Imam al-Mursaleen, Ya Mustafa, Ya Shafi'a al-Alamin, Ya Mustafa, Ya Imam al-Mursaleen, Ya Mustafa, Ya Shafi'a al-Alamin, Ya Mustafa. Salu ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
Any other requests? No? You guys are very quiet tonight. Need some voices, need some energy. You guys, it sounds like you guys are here just to eat food. Right, okay, for this next one, I want you to all get involved, right? The words are very simple. Even though we've been told that we need to stick to English, this one's gonna involve three languages. So for you guys who know the words, join in. For those who don't know the words, hum along. For those who don't know how to hum along, just pretend like you're humming along. Can you have a loud? So the words go, Ya Nabi Salam Alaika. It's very simple. With submission, faith, and patience, you conveyed the noble message, brought us light through your guidance. Peace be upon you, oh, our teacher. Ya Habibi, Ya Muhammad, Ya Nabi, Salam Alayka, Ya Rasul, Salam Alayka, Ya Habib, Salam Alayka, Salawatullah Alayka. أيها المختار فينا زادنا الحب حنينا جئتنا بالخير دينا يا ختام المرسلين يا حبيبي يا محمد يا نبي سلام عليك يا رسول سلام عليك يا حبيب سلام عليك. Louder guys, louder. صلوات الله عليك يا نبي سلام عليك يا حبيب. It's very easy. It's very, very easy, guys. Ya Nabi, Ya Habib, Ya Rasul, Salawatullah Alayka. Teri mohabbat ki mehak se ye zameen o aasman abad hai, rehmat ki barsaat aati hai dil o jaan. Ya Rasool Allah, Ya Habibi, Ya Muhammad, Ya Nabi. Louder, louder. Ya Ya Rasul, Ya Habib, Salawatullah Alayka. Salu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. So for this very last one, we've been requested to recite one. Although it's slightly off topic, I think it's actually on topic, because in this world that we live in, the people that we live around, the terrorists that we live amongst, try and ruin the name of Islam. And in fact, the biggest victims of terrorism are the Muslims themselves. So this is a nasheed called Freedom. It is a nasheed that I all want you to get involved with. So those of you who are enjoying your food for a few minutes, I just want you to get involved. I can see a few guys there that are not stopping eating. You guys have to stop eating just for a few minutes, okay? And I want you to join along. The words are freedom, freedom, okay? You can't go wrong, okay? So firstly, I just want to hear all of you say freedom.
Freedom.
Louder.
Freedom.
Say it again.
Freedom.
Fantastic. So I know you know the words now, okay? Okay, let's have a loud salawat. Gathered here with my family, my neighbors and my friends, standing firm together against oppression, holding hands. Doesn't matter where you're from, if you're young, old woman or man, we're here for the same reasons. We want to take back our land. Oh God, thank you for giving us strength to hold on. And now we're here together calling you for freedom, freedom. We know you can hear our call. Oh God, we're calling for
freedom.
We know you can hear our call. Oh God, we're calling for freedom, fighting for freedom. We know you won't let us fall. Oh God, we know you're here with us. No more being prisoners in our homes. No more being afraid to talk. Our dream is to be free, just to be free. And now we've taken our first steps towards a life of complete freedom. We can see our dreams getting closer and closer. We're almost there. Oh God, thank you for giving us strength to hold on. And now we're here together calling you for
freedom.
We know you can hear our call. Oh God. Guys, come on, come on. We're calling for
freedom.
Know you can hear our call. Oh God. You know, I have been known to call people onto the stage to recite along with us, so don't make me do that. We're calling for
freedom.
We know you can hear our call. Oh God, we're calling for freedom, fighting for freedom. We know you won't let us fall. Oh God, we know you're here with us. We know you're here with us. Can I have a loud salawat, please?
There are some people in the world that say the Prophet is gone. What do we learn from the Prophet? Why was the Prophet sent and he didn't live forever? But the answer is, the Prophet came and the Prophet went. No, the Prophet's here, he never left. A message he delivered, righteously mankind he helped. On the earth with the chisel of knowledge, wisdom he engraved. This he left when he left this world. His greatness we can never know. His life we must study in depth. O Allah, let us follow your guides. The laws you give, let us abide. Let us enjoy beauty and humanity. like the islands of sand that form on the low tide. Your signs are so bright, our eyes we close. Allow them to open so we can increase our sight. And with this, I'd like to call upon Sheikh Hilli to come to the front and enlighten us and educate us on who this man was, who this man is till this day. He is Muhammad, the reformer, Muhammad, the revolutionist, Muhammad, the prophet. And with that, I'd like to call upon Sheikh Hilli with a loud salawat, ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. If I can request the audience to finish their food while the lecture is going on, so we can all pay attention and learn more about our blessed Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam.
أعوذ بالله السميع العليم من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين بارئ الخلائق أجمعين باعث الأنبياء والمرسلين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف خلقه وخاتم أنبيائه وسيد رسله نبينا وحبيب قلوبنا وشفيع ذنوبنا أبي القاسم محمد وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين المطهرين وعلى أصحابه المنتجبين وعلى جميع الأنبياء والمرسلين قال الله العظيم في كتابه الكريم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم يا أيها النبي إنا أرسلناك شاهدا ومبشرا ونذيرا وداعيا إلى الله بإذنه وسراجا منيرا آمنا بالله صدق الله العلي العظيم Respected brothers and sisters, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته It's an honor and a privilege to be amongst you here city of Birmingham or shall I say Birmingham, because ham is haram in Islam, and I heard that Birmingham is only populated by Muslims, or perhaps that's a Fox News fact, and I haven't been on Fox News, alhamdulillah. Indeed, each and every one of us strives and seeks to attain and to receive information and news that places joy and happiness in their hearts. Something intrinsically that we desire. If a person is a bearer of good news, we respect them. We love them. We love to hear from them. News today, unfortunately, is gloomy. We receive news from different people from around the world, which is not necessarily good. Yet even when we receive positive information, this depends upon the receiver. It's subjective. Sometimes news can be good to one person and to another may be negative. I recall this particular incident, so they say, which some of you may have come across, that there was a man whose wife was about to give birth. She was going through labor. He takes her to hospital so that the delivery could take place. He decides that he does not want to be part of the process. He does not want to see his wife giving birth. He waits outside in the waiting area to be given the news about the delivery of his son or daughter. While sitting there, he's sitting next to two other men who are also waiting for the news of their wives or their partners to give birth. All of a sudden, after a while, the nurse or the midwife comes out. She says to one of them, the three who are sitting there, there's good news. The news is that your wife has given birth to what? Twins. You have two young children now. This man stands up, wants to go see his wife, is seen smiling. The other two men say to him, why are you so happy? He says, I find it a coincidence. I work for a company, a hotel chain known as Doubletree. And therefore, God has given me two children. He disappears. After a while, then that same nurse comes out and speaks to the second person and says, there is wonderful news for you. Your wife has given birth. But amazingly, she's given birth to what? Triplets. He's now laughing. People say to him, why are you laughing? He says, I work for a mobile phone company called Three. He disappears. Now the third man is seen sweating profusely, walking back and forth, very agitated, very anxious. Someone comes to him and says, what's wrong with you? Are you okay? He says, I'm not okay. They say, why? He says, because I work for 7-Up. Good news is subjective. Somebody may receive it, may perceive it as what? As not necessarily positive. Yet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, my dear brothers and sisters, says the news that comes from him is emphatically positive. And he says, this news that I'm delivering to you will be delivered by the best bearer of good news. Ya ayyuhan nabi, inna arsalnaka shahidan wa mubashiran wa nadhira. Allah says, the greatest human being and the best of his creation, a man who is revered and respected like no other human being in the history of mankind, Rasul al-A'zam Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. Is known as Al-Bashir al-Nadhir, the one who comes forward first and foremost with good news. And this announcement all began in the year that people associated with positivity, with a wonderful atmosphere, and that's the year of the elephant. Yes? There was a ruler, a Jewish ruler by the name of Dhul Nawas. This man heard that the area, he was the ruler of Yemen, he heard that in Abyssinia, people were not willing to accept Judaism. They were Christians. What did he do? He sent an army, he went and he conquered this land of what? Abyssinia. And he said to the people, either you Christians or you all be killed. This is described in the Quran in Surah Al-Buruj. Was-samai dhatil buruj. Yes, this is Ashabul Ukhdud, that the Christians said, no, we will not convert. What did he do? He buried them alive. He had trenches and he buried them alive. 20,000 were killed by this individual. Now the Roman emperor heard about this particular atrocity. So what did he do? He sent an army to defeat this particular ruler. And when this ruler was defeated, there was a man who was placed as the head of Yemen. His name was Abraha. And now the story makes a bit more sense. Because Abraha built this temple, wanted people to come and to pray there, but he recognized that the attention that he was getting was not satisfactory. He inquired and he was told there is a place of visitation which is indeed honored by people, and they go to it from around Arabia, and that is in Mecca. He decides to do what? He decides to completely destroy the house of God, the Holy Kaaba. He takes the army, which is composed of what? Men and elephants. And the Quran describes the story, of course, of Ashab al-Fil, that we all know very well, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala destroyed them completely. And indeed, it was on that year that the Prophet of Islam was born as an individual whose year of birth was associated with what? With positive news. Who was Rasulullah? Rasulullah, my dear brothers and sisters, is a man who is followed like no other human being. A man who is remembered like no other. An individual who is honored like no other. But importantly, a human being that changed the world like no other. One term, one expression that is continuously presented and used by many people around the world today is reform. You find institutions, governments, organizations, businesses, they all talk about constitutional reform, organizational reform. Reform is the word of the moment. It seems to be the fashion out there. Everybody talks about what? The need to reform. And indeed, you look, for instance, into the history of this country, the United Kingdom, and you appreciate that, as an example, when it comes to elections, today we take it for granted, this year is the year of the elections, isn't it, in this country? But you look back in 1832, there was a law that was passed, or an act. It was called the Reform Act. Did you know that before 1832, Birmingham and Manchester did not have a single MP in the UK Parliament? Did not have a single one. And do you know why? Because the electoral system at that time was designed, and the way it worked was surrounding the people and their possessions, and how many houses they had, for example. The wealth of the people that lived in a particular area. So for instance, we are told that there were some rotten boroughs, like for instance, the area known as Sarum at Salisbury. They had two MPs, but that area had seven people living there only. They had two MPs. And they came forward with this type of constitutional, so to speak, reform to instigate or to allow more individuals to take part in the general election. And after this reform act was passed by Parliament, due to the pressure of certain unions, ironically in Birmingham and Manchester, the number of the people who could vote rose from 300,000 to 600,000. But this was the beginning of the process of reform. You find famous reformists, reformers like whom? Like Martin Luther. Who is Martin Luther? This Christian theologian, this individual who is responsible for the what? For the Protestant Reformation. This man who says a few things which are very interesting. He says, you are not only responsible for the things that you say, but you're also responsible for the things that you don't say. And one of the things that he also mentioned was, he says, I have held many things in my hands, yet I've lost them. However, whenever I place anything in the hands of God, I still possess them. These are words of this particular scholar. He was known as a reformer in society. People like Mother Teresa. You have Gandhi, Martin Luther King, and his mission to denounce what? Racism and bigotry. These are names that are presented before us that the world know as great reformers. Yet today, there can be no reformer who comes close to the achievement of the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. Brothers and sisters, today scientists, psychologists, sociologists say it is incredibly difficult within a short period of time to change the mindset and the practices of people. This is established today. We find it in our day-to-day lives. If we develop a habit, it becomes very hard to take ourselves out of it, especially if it's one practiced by a community or a society. In fact, scientists have demonstrated through experimentation that change takes time. Reform needs years upon years, hundreds of years sometimes, because people normally stick to things that they're comfortable, and normally, under normal circumstances, they do not wish to investigate why they're doing what they do. And you know, there was a famous American psychologist, his name is Harry Harlow. He conducted this experiment, fascinating experiment, that highlights this is not only a trait within the human beings, but also amongst animals. He had six monkeys, and he kept these six monkeys where? In a cage or in a room. And they had a banana or a bunch of bananas hanging from the ceiling, and what? A ladder. Yet every time one of the monkeys would what? Climb up the ladder to try and grab some of these monkeys, cold water would be poured on top of the monkey. Every time they would go up, cold water would fall on them, they would leave the banana and come down. And each of the six tried, and the same result was witnessed by the six monkeys. What did they do, this Professor Harlow? What did he do? He took out one monkey of the six and replaced him with another, external, another one from outside. Now, five of the six knew what would happen if you go up. Water would be spilt on you. But the sixth monkey who had just been introduced had no idea. So what did he do? He wanted to go up, but they witnessed that the other five monkeys would hold the monkey from doing what? From going up. Don't go, they would say to him in their monkey language. Yes? What happened? One by one of these five, they were removed and replaced with other monkeys. At the end, there were six monkeys there who were never affected by water. In other words, they never went up, right? They never had the impact, yet none of them would go up. And the conclusion was that they were discouraged by the others, not knowing why. It was set. It's not good to go, don't go, but the reason, it's not important. In other words, people are happy, and if this can be, this result can be to human beings, and we see it today in our common day-to-day interactions. People are happy to do what they're accustomed to, what they set their minds and their lives to do, right? And hence you find the prophets, when they come to tell people about the message of monotheism, what is the response? Oh, but our forefathers used to practice it, therefore we'll keep at it. And that is a danger. And hence, when we look at the Holy Prophet and his achievement, 23 years, the transformation and the legacy, one cannot help but stand in admiration and in awe of the great achievement of the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. Just a quick note about the condition of society. Strive with corruption and evil. Girls born, buried as soon as they're born, no economic system, no literacy, violence, that was strife, all these. And yet the Prophet of Islam introduces and establishes this change in society that was fundamental in many ways. How did he do so? Brothers and sisters, he was not a man of theory. He did not come and forward and say, this must change. He was a man of what? Of practice. He walked the walk as well as talked the talk, right? What did he do? He came and he connected with the innate nature of human beings. He connected with the fitrah, and they could see his exemplary individual as a man who was what? who is a great role model for people to follow. Therefore, when he comes forward and says, "La farq bayn a'rabiyyin wa a'jamiyyin illa bit-taqwa," there is no difference between an Arab and a non-Arab except with God consciousness. What does he do? He comes forward and appoints Bilal al-Habashi as the one who pronounces and calls the adhan. And he gives him what? The responsibility of being in charge of the finances. He comes forward and honors Salman al-Muhammadi al-Farisi. In other words, people saw that he was not just claiming, but he demonstrated it what? In action. And one of the qualities that the Prophet of Islam had as one of, as the most successful reformer in the history of mankind is what? Determination like no other. He was set the goal of establishing righteousness, justice, and prosperity for all. Yet he came forward and was unfazed. They said, "We'll give you everything that you want. We'll give you the women. We'll give you wealth. We'll give you the leadership of Quraysh." He says to his uncle Abu Talib, Ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhi, who was a believer in Islam. He's what? He says to him, "Oh my uncle, if they give me the sun on my right hand and the moon on my left, so that I abandon this mission, I will never do so until God the Almighty establishes it on this earth." And this was the what? The sheer determination of the Holy Prophet. Yet indeed he had vision. Notice, all these important qualities grouped together gives him this everlasting legacy of the greatest reformer. What was one of his vision? And that was to strengthen unity and the bond amongst the people. That's why I invite you, my dear brothers and sisters, at the time when Muslims are being attacked, at the time where the Prophet of Islam is being ridiculed and mocked, to read the Charter of Medina. One of the first things that Rasulullah did when he reached the city of Medina, he did what? He established this brotherhood between the Muhajirin and the Ansar, between the ones who were the migrants and the supporters. And in this, what did he establish? He created this cohesive community. But thereafter, there was this charter that outlines the justice of Rasulullah. He dealt with non-Muslims, non-believers, that they enjoyed protection from God, that they were not to be forced or coerced into religion, that they should be honored. And therefore, what do you find? You find people responded spectacularly to the message of the Holy Prophet of Islam and continue to do so today. When we look at his legacy as a reformer, we understand that one of the key features that the Prophet of Islam focused upon was what? The moral decline of the society at that time. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَإِنَّكَ لَعَلَىٰ خُلُقٍ عَظِيمٍ. He worked to reform the akhlaq, the etiquettes, the mannerism of people. I remember reading this beautiful story that he had what? He had a servant by the name of Anas ibn Malik. This particular servant one day said, "I prepared food for the Prophet of Islam. And he was fasting. I prepared his iftar. And I waited at the time of what? Of Maghrib. But the Prophet never turned up." Right? An hour, 2 hours, 3 hours, several hours went by and the Prophet did not turn up. Therefore, what did I do? I thought to myself, the Prophet was invited somewhere. Therefore, he had iftar somewhere. Right? And he's eaten. I decided to eat the food myself. I consumed the food. The Prophet returns. I learn that the Prophet had not had his iftar, except that he had broken his fast with some water. Back in the time, there was no, you know, local fish chops or chicken and chips. There was no area to order some food. If you don't have any food at home, that's it. The Prophet came, saw that the food is not there, was eaten. What did he do? Did he come and say to this particular servant of his, "Why did you eat my food? I'm now hungry. What are you going to do? Get me some food now." Did he do that? The narration tells us he was silent. He never mentioned it. Went to sleep. Anas says, "I never heard a thing from the Prophet about this at all." Notice, a heart that was so loving, so compassionate, even when wrong or make mistakes or commit errors. Yet the Prophet of Islam oozed with forgiveness and what? And mercy. Indeed, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ. I'd like to give you one example before we end of the instrumental methodology of the Prophet instigating and establishing reform. This is in chapter 33, verse number 37, one of the most controversial stories in the life of the Holy Prophet that has been pounced upon by the enemies of Islam like Robert Spencer and others who seek to defame the character of the Holy Prophet. This is his marriage to whom? To Zainab bint Jahsh. And the story is that there was a man by the name of Zayd ibn Haritha al-Kilabi or al-Kalbi. This individual was what? A slave who was gifted to the most beloved wife of the Holy Prophet, Sayyidah Khadija, peace be upon her, and she later on gifted him to the Holy Prophet. So now Zayd was what? Was owned by the Prophet. The Prophet of Islam frees him, and his family come to take him, yet he chooses to stay with Rasulullah. Rasulullah later on makes him his adopted son, and they would call him Zayd ibn Muhammad. Zayd, the son of Muhammad. What happened? He marries this Zayd ibn Haritha. Marries whom? Marries Zainab bint Jahsh. And when he marries Zainab bint Jahsh, the marriage doesn't work out. Sometimes this happens. In other words, they did not place the effort to make them successful. The Quran tells us that every time Zayd came to the Prophet said, work on your marriage. Yet they had been given knowledge by God the Almighty that one day he shall be Zainab bint Jahsh. But he recognized as a man of responsibility, as a leader in society, he should not say to Zayd, yes, I know, one day I will be married to this particular woman, so you might as well divorce her. No. He, according to the Quran, would continuously stress the importance of Zayd keeping the marital relationship alive. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, until eventually Zayd said what? Zayd said, no, I cannot keep this marriage. There was a divorce. And after the Adda period, the Prophet of Islam married Zainab. Why? To legislate law. At that time, it was known amongst the pagans, amongst Arabia, people of Arabia, that if you have an adopted son, and what? And they are married, even if they divorce their wife, you are not to marry that particular individual, the wife of your adopted son or your ex-wife. It was something established amongst the people. In order to legislate this law and reform this concept, the Prophet showed what? Courage. Now here's the problem. Today, one of the things that we have is, unfortunately, narrations in Muslim books that says the Prophet passed by and saw Zainab when the curtain was removed and his eyes was enchanted by her and somehow he fell in love with her. And these are in common books that are followed by many Muslims. And Muslims who seek to defame the Prophet, what do? They say, what is this about the Holy Prophet? You say this, that this individual did so and so and fell in love in such a particular manner. Where today we stand to exonerate and what? Denounce such narrations. Because the Prophet of Islam is an individual who stands at the pinnacle of humanity when it comes to his mannerism, his spirituality, his service to mankind, and his legacy that today we are witnessing that due to his impact, Islam is the largest growing religion in the world. And this is a fact that we have to embrace. I would like to leave you with the following. That today, my dear brothers and sisters, as we honor and we celebrate and we stand in admiration of the great personality of Rasulullah Muhammad al-Mustafa sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. An individual whom people have not truly understood. The Quran says, "Inna kafaynaka al-mustahzi'een." A promise from God. Allah says, whomsoever mocks you, ridicules you, Ya Rasulullah, don't worry about them. We have protected you from them. Why? Because the Quran says, وَرَفَعْنَا لَكَ ذِكْرَكَ. Your remembrance, Ya Allah, shall forever be raised and remembered. Beings, tell me each and every day how many times you and I remember Rasulullah in our prayers, in tashahud. At least 18 times we remember him. If you multiply this by the number of Muslims who pray, there is nobody who comes close to Rasulullah as far as his remembrance is concerned. Indeed, this is the promise of God. Yet, how do we look at the Prophet and become reformers in our own selves, within our own communities and societies? Reform is needed, brothers and sisters. Without reform, we suffer with stagnation. We become rigid. We become individuals who are what? Who are not progressive. We need to look at the Prophet of Islam as the greatest role model when it comes to reform in society to advance this cause. When we say we need reform, we are not talking about reform when it comes to the principles of the religion of Islam. Reform is not to change what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has set as obligatory. Let me give you an example. One day I was having a Q&A session and there was a few brothers and sisters, right? And one sister asked a question. She said, can you please tell us, can we have a 21st century hijab? I said, what does that mean? Is it a Gucci one or a CK one? What is a 21st century hijab? Islam has come forward and said hijab is wajib categorically. There is no basis for anyone who says the Quran doesn't say it. It says it at least two times. The Prophet and the teachings of the righteous companions and the Ahlul Bayt, they all come forward and say hijab is wajib, and it's unanimously agreed by Muslims. There is no scope for questioning this. Yet, there is the concept of hijab, right? Hijab should be the modest dress code for a woman that covers her entire body except her face or and her hands, which is loose and is not attractive. Whatever it is, other than that, that's fine. But why are we trying to somehow, in the name of modernity, fit in society by what? By saying, you know what? I'm not that keen with some of the Islamic principles that are out there. I want it to be more compatible with the West. When we're talking about reform, we're not talking about things which are set as obligatory and in the teachings of the religion of Islam. We're talking about our own conduct and the way we have understood the religion. Please understand this important point. Let me give you a number of examples. Across the board, my dear brothers and sisters, we have to ask this soul-searching question: where am I from the greatest reformer in the history of mankind? Where am I? Yes? How have I responded to his call? How have I answered his request for you and I to instigate that change in our world? Personally, my relationship with God, I find it sometimes difficult, and it pains me that I hear that the youth, some of our youth, they struggle, for instance, to wake up for Fajr prayers. Simple issue. But they say it's hard. They stay up at night, you know, chilling, chillaxing. And then they say, oh, it's hard to wake up, especially what, in the summer, when it's at 2 or 3, right? Morning. You say, oh, it's very hard for me. This relationship that I have with God, the Almighty subhanahu wa ta'ala, do I need to reform it for the better or not? Likewise, the way I understand how my religion have stipulated how I should interact with others. And in one particular example I would like to give, and that is social networking. It's a powerful tool. It's a wonderful area in which you and I can be able to introduce ourselves to others, can spread the beautiful teachings of the religion. But today, am I an individual who needs to re-examine my conduct out there when I'm communicating with others? Have I practiced religion, Islam, part-time? In other words, in the mosque, or at home, or when I come to interacting with others on an forum, all of a sudden the garment of the religion is left on the side and is pushed? Is that something that I should be thinking about or not? Likewise, look at, for instance, And I'm here giving some examples, just examples of where areas we need to look at a community level, at a personal level, and a society level, where we need to think about reforming our practices. Once again, it's very difficult for us sometimes to see. And I tell you, my dear brothers and sisters, it pains me. And it pains some of the ulama out there, and I'm a student, right, of Islam, that when we see slowly as we are establishing ourselves in the West, somehow our Islamic values and principles are becoming diluted. And let me give you an example, weddings. What happens in weddings, right? God help us in weddings, yes? Somehow we think, you know what? It's a day off. Mixed weddings, music, dancing, hijab is not practiced, so on and so forth. When I said to someone, what are you doing? He said, Mawlana, relax, it's one day. So Allah says, one day, it's okay? Where does it say this? Islam is not a part-time religion that we put on a Saturday or a Sunday. Islam is a comprehensive 24 hours. It's a cliche, but we have to say it. Yes? Why is it that I feel that somehow I can interpret religion the way I want to, or I can change it the way I want to? Have I looked at these particular practices? Have I allowed to what? To dictate my actions? Yes? I speak to people. You know what? Sometimes my cousin, my relative, you know, who is a non-mahram, yeah, you know what, that's fine. I hug them, they hug me, handshake, everything. I say to them, how is this allowed? They say, well, you know, brother, we've lived all our lives in the same house. Okay, so what? Yes, but it's okay, it's practice in a particular, it's fine, you know, don't worry, I'll never marry them. It's not about that. It's about the principle that we have to adhere to. It's not about picking and what? Picking and choosing. Likewise, today, as majority of the brothers and sisters here perhaps are at university level, have we ever pondered about what are we doing in terms of our responsibility for standing in honor of the Holy Prophet and reforming some of our conduct at university level? Are we giving the name of the religion of Islam what? A positive boost when we are at university, or is it negative? Let me give you an example. I was, alhamdulillah, at university, London, and I remember there was a friend who was a Hindu. He used to come with us sometimes, you know, we sit down, discuss, used to eat with us. Or to pray, we say to him, we're going to pray, right? There's no shame in what saying to people that this is my faith and this is something that I indeed look forward to. It's something that gives me that buzz, that energy. Yes? One day I remember that, you know, I left university now 14 years, but this story has left in my mind. And I hope that we do not see it, but I hear that unfortunately it is somehow creeping into our mentality. What happened? He was eating with us at the cafeteria. Before doing so, there were a few brothers eating. All of a sudden, he brings his tray, sits next to us in the same table to eat. There was a brother, a Muslim brother, immediately in the midst of eating, picks up his tray and sits on another table. I looked at him and said, what are you doing? He said, brother, Hindu, astaghfirullah, mushrik, same table. But why? Which Islam are you following? Muhammad is your leader. I tell you, it's that I look at an exemplary role model, because he did not teach this. This is your way, your misinformed, misguided thinking about the religion of Islam, about the teachings of the religion. And I came to this individual. I said to him, I'm really sorry. Don't be offended. He said, no, it's okay. Then he asked me, what did he? I said, don't worry. Later on, this individual, and this is a true story, I did not Google it or read it from my YouTube, okay? Or watched it. This is an individual who came forward, what? And said, can I come and watch you pray? I said, yeah, come and watch us pray. We were there at university for 4 years. Allah has witnessed that after the end of the 4 years, he came and he recited his shahada. Not because of me or anyone else, but because there is a profound impact when people realize the beauty of Rasulullah in the magnificence of the religion of Islam. You've just got to act it the way it is. There's no need for spinning. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَنْ أَحْسَنُ قَوْلًا مِمَّنْ دَعَى إِلَى اللَّهِ إِلَى صَالِحًا وَقَالَ إِنَّنِي مِنَ الْمُسْلِمِينَ. Allah says, who is better than the one who does what? Who invites people towards the religion through their conduct and their speech and says, I am one of the Muslims. And today, as the world is continuously searching and looking for answers about our holy beloved Prophet, we honor him and defend him and stand in solidarity with him as the what? As the greatsman and reformer and a man who has this legacy like no other, by doing what? Not just by changing our Facebook statuses, but by understanding his status. Not by changing and looking at what? Our own way of talking about the Prophet, but more so learning about his, from his example, and reading about his seerah, and appreciating his great achievements. And finally, we become followers of this great Prophet of God as a great reformer by obeying him, scrutinizing ourselves as far as our relationship with him, knowing very well how we converse with the non-Muslims about the beautiful personality of our beloved Prophet. Do you know why? Because one day he was sitting with his companions and he said, may Allah bless my brothers. And the companion said, aren't we your brothers, Ya Rasulullah? And one narration that I saw, the Prophet of Islam was weeping. He said, I wish I can meet my brothers. And he was told, well, who are your brothers, Ya Rasulullah? He said, my brothers and sisters, of course, are the ones who will come after me. They believe in me. They follow me. You never met me. And the Prophet of Islam is waiting for each and every one of us to become his ambassador, to raise the flag, whatever we are. The question is, are we ready and will we respond? Wa akhiru da'wana an alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen wa sallallahu ala Muhammadin wa alihi at-tayyibin at-tahirin.
Thank you very much, Sheikh, for that enlightening speech. And it's true what he says. The only way we can change society is if we make a change within ourselves. So from today, when we leave the celebration of the Prophet's birthday, we should become people that make change within ourselves. But what type of change, you may ask? The change should be the reflection of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wa alihi wasallam's actions, and his sunnah should be reflected within us. And then we don't even need to say a word. All we need to do is walk and be me and be you, and the world will change, because one man has changed an entire mankind. The whole world has changed because of him, and we are his followers, so we can make another change, and this change can cascade upon the whole of humanity. And that is our aim, and that is why the Prophet was sent to us. And with that, I'd request another very loud, with a higher volume, salawat ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. And now, obviously, the famous moment, the most awaited moment of tonight's program has arrived. It's now dinner time. But before I request the waiters to bring out the dinner from India, it's been brought over. Don't worry, it's fresh. Before I request them to bring out the food, I just want to make a very important announcement. And that announcement is, we live in a technological era. We live in the selfie age. This selfie age, firstly, I'd count myself as a moderate, occasional selfie person, if that's what you call it. But tonight, I give you the permission to pull out your phones during dinner time and go around wherever you want, taking selfies with your friends, taking pictures of everything, and then posting them on social media, Twitter, Instagram, Facebook, with the hashtag Milad Nabi 2015. And now, I give permission to the people of the kitchen, bring out the food. And with that, I leave you a verse from the Holy Quran, the verses that were recited from the Prophet himself. And obviously, I'm not your parents, but just a few words of wisdom from our holy book. كُلُوا وَاشْرَبُوا وَلَا تُسْرِفُوا إِنَّهُ لَا يُحِبُّ الْمُسْرِفُونَ. Eat and drink, but do not waste, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not love the person who wastes. And obviously, we here are raising money for the charities Noor Orphans and Lady Sumaya Trust. We want to give them the life that we have lived. So tonight, let us enjoy the food in their name and donate generously. And remember, salawat ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
All right, salawat ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. Right, so guys, the Absock Awards, this is how it's going to work. As you can see, we've got five pairs. Sorry, I don't want to block anyone. We've got five pairs here, each representing five different Absocks. What's going to happen is we have three rounds of questions. Each pair will have to answer the questions either individually or conferring. And they'll be given 30 seconds to answer the questions. What's going to happen then after is we're going to tally up the scores. And we're going to determine which two Absocks of the five have scored the highest amount of points, Aston Uni. So, then what's going to happen is, after the third round, the two Absocks which have scored the highest amount of points will go through to a wildfire, quickfire, rapid fire, sudden death finale round, and they'll enjoy themselves, inshallah, and one Absock will walk away the champions of the Absock Milad 2015.
Inshallah. Okay, so just a heads up for the participants and the audience. So we've added a lifeline. So that's ask the audience. So at any point in the quiz, if you have a question that you can't answer, you'll have the opportunity to once in the three rounds ask any member of the audience who knows the answer to answer that question. But remember, use it wisely because you only have one chance. So people in the audience, please put your hands up if you know the answer if you're asked. And that way we'll save time.
Thank right, you. That's how he's Chris Tarrant, right? You get the lifeline. All right. Okay, cool. So just to explain, participants, you know the rules. Audience, you know the rules. Okay, round one is the first round. Round one is on Quranic knowledge. Once again, just to clarify, each pair gets 30 seconds to answer a question. You can confer in your pairs, and then what's going to happen is, if you get the point, you get the point. If you don't, sorry, move on. And then inshallah, we'll go on to the following rounds. Can we have the round one slide up, please? So the time starts after we say the first question. Are we ready? Salawat.
Okay. Just before we start, I'd just like to share a small hadith with you all from our holy prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. And where he says, the best of you are those who learn the Quran and teach it. So inshallah, from this round, we will all learn something new about the Quran, and inshallah, then go home and spread it to our parents, as most of us here are students. So. Okay, inshallah. Okay, let's start.
Okay, round one. Your time starts for DMU. DMU, when I say, after I repeat the question. Okay, question one. What surah number is Surah Muhammad? Your time starts now. Surah Muhammad. If you know it in the audience, keep the answer in your mind in case they want to ask you guys. You say, ladies first. 10 seconds, seven.
Surah 16,
final answer?
Final answer,
incorrect, that's sorry about that. The answer is Surah 47 is Surah Muhammad. Can we have a salawat?
Okay, so our next question will be for Lester Absock. Once I say the question, you'll have 30 seconds to answer it, okay? So, name two other names for Surah Fatiha.
Time starts now.
Yeah. Arabic. Two other names for Surah Fatiha.
You got 15 seconds. Think of the answer in the head, guys, in the audience, if you know it. You can use a lifeline.
Can we get half a point?
You have 5 seconds.
4, 3,
Umul Kitab.
Okay. And okay. Time. Sorry.
Okay. Do you know any more?
No.
Okay. That's half a point for Lester Absock. Other names are?
Okay, so some of the other names, so they did get one. So some of the other names we have are Al-Quran Atim, Al-Hamd, As-Sala, As-Shifa, Ar-Ruqa, and Sabul Matni. Sorry, apologies. My Arabic's not too good, sorry.
All right, okay, so the next uni is Coventry University. You guys ready? Okay, so question 3, your time starts after I repeat the question. Name 4 surahs in the Holy Quran named after one of the holy prophets of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Your time starts now. 4 surahs.
Yasin.
Sorry, Yasin.
Yeah.
Keep going. You need to name 4.
Yasin. Taha.
So.
Ibrahim.
You need to speak louder.
Okay, so Yasin, Taha, Maryam. Not Maryam?
Yunus.
Okay, Yasin, Taha, Yunus, and?
Ibrahim.
Okay, with 1 second to spare. That is Coventry Absock, right? Can we have a salawat for Coventry Absock? So unfortunately, sorry, Yasin is not a name of a holy prophet. It doesn't. Sorry, Yasin is kind of disputed, right? Yes? No? Sheikh Hilly, is Surah Yasin named after a holy prophet, as in the name Yasin? Okay, that's fine. Alright, okay. Coventry Absock also said Surah Yunus, which is correct, and Surah Ibrahim, which is correct. That's 3/4 of points. Does that count?
Yeah. I think that's half.
Okay, that's half a point for Coventry Absock. Can we have a salawat?
Okay, so the next question for UOB. Okay, so once I say the question, you have 30 seconds. Okay, so what are the other names of the Quran according to the Quran itself? Starting now.
That's 3 other names of the Holy Quran. You can use a lifeline, guys, you know, if you don't know.
You have 20 seconds.
I'm surprised no one's used it.
Al-Kitab.
No. Keep going.
Al-Furqan.
Okay, keep going. 5 seconds.
No, it's a different
one. Nur.
Time. Okay, so that was Al-Kitab, Al-Furqan, and
Nur.
Okay, correct. That's all 3. So, mashallah.
Woo!
That's a point for UOB.
We have a salawat. So, UOB are in the lead, unfortunately. Right. Okay, come on, Aston Absock, let's do this. Yeah. Woo! Okay. Let's go, Aston Absock. Yeah. All right, guys.
No pressure.
All right, your time starts after I repeat the question, Aston Absock. Question 5, according to the Holy Quran, what is the root of all evil? Your time starts now.
Is there one or is there more than one? Ahmed, is there one or more than one?
Just say one.
Lying.
Alright, so Aston Absock said lying is the root of all evil according to the Holy Quran. Unfortunately, that's not the right answer. Sorry, Aston, I love you, but you know, pain hurts. Alright, the answer is alcohol. I'm not. This is the Holy Quran, mate. I didn't make these rules. All right, guys. Salawat.
Okay, so we'll just have a look at the scoreboards now. So where's the... Sister Safeerja is taking the scores.
So who's top? not DME. Okay, first place, UOB so far.
Yeah, UOB!
Right, Coventry and Birmingham are... Right, okay. Okay, so who's top and who's fifth? Okay, so UOB are first. Who followed by? Coventry, Leicester. And then DMU and Aston, unfortunately. Okay. Okay. All right.
Standard.
All right, mate. Okay, so, I mean, do you know what? As much as I despise University of Birmingham, I'm joking. You know what? I think to myself, we can't always be at war with each other, right? I mean, Aston, UOB, we're from the same city, the same holy city of Birmingham. Am I right? Yes. We've got to feel bad for some of the other contestants. They're gharib, they're pilgrims from, you know, the Zawar from Leicester, the LEDC of Leicester. We've got to feel bad for them, right? What do you think, Jose?
Yeah, I get what you mean. I mean, even Leicester Absoc had to bring two Absocs to the one event. You know, no, but in all fairness, we do love Leicester Absoc, and we really enjoyed the event last year, and we wish the best of luck to all the teams.
Yeah, we're just joking, guys. Okay, so, round two, do you want to explain it?
Okay, so round two, just to introduce it to you all. So it's called Who Said It? So your ears will be put to the test. So you'll hear a short sound clip, and then you'll have 30 seconds to answer who said the quote that was on
right.
The sound clip.
So just okay. To confirm, we're going to play sound clips to the participants. That's just all 10 of them this time. That's not one per pair. So what's going to happen is, we're going to play a sound clip to each participant. They can confirm their pairs, and then they've got to let us know who they think it is. It's going to be someone famous, or it's going to be from somewhere famous. The question is, who said it? All right, so. Okay. Salwa.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala.
Nasser, okay. Are you ready with the sound clips?
Okay. All right. Okay, so we'll start with Aston here. Okay, so the first sound clip, please.
Put the volume up, Nasser. That's not right. That's the Nasheed. That's not right.
Sorry, this is the wrong sound clip. Play Nasir because he's from Leicester.
Turn off the Nasheed.
A laptop. Come on, Nasir, man. What did we hire you for? Come on.
Nasir, pause the Nasheed and then play the first sound clip. You guys can use your lifelines, don't forget. Two rounds left. Come on, Aston. Counting on you.
Okay. All right, first sound clip, please. This is
for you. Nasr literally means time that is running out. It's the last part of the day when the day is running out. It's time of Asr prayer.
Can you just replay that for us, please?
We'll replay that.
Literally means time that is running out. It's the last part of the day when the day is running out. It's time of Asr prayer.
The time starts now. You've got 10
seconds. So they've used their Ask the Audience. So anyone who heard that and could guess who it was.
Does anyone in the audience know the answer?
Do you want to ask? Who do you want to AJ?
AJ or Zainab, who do you want to choose? Okay, we'll play it once more.
Nasr literally means time that is running out. It's the last part of the day when the day is running out. It's time of Asr prayer.
Anyone?
AJ or Zainab? Who wants to ask someone?
No, you can't. You have to choose someone with a hand up. You can't shout.
You can't shout out an answer, guys. AJ has to pick someone.
Who do you pick? Come on, guys. Come on.
Was that a serious answer?
Come on, just choose someone. Choose someone next. Okay. Okay. No.
Guys, come on, no more jokes. One guy who knows the answer on the boy on the guy side.
Choose someone. Hasnain Rajabli is your answer, okay? Unfortunately, that was incorrect. It was Numan Ali Khan. Okay, so the next sound clip, please. So you have
right, guys, we're going to play the next sound clip for Aston Uni.
Can you guys AJ please be quiet? Still it's already with each difficult other. To hear it as it is. Okay, another one for you guys. Okay,
let's play.
Keep you.
I'm going to float like a butterfly and sting like a bee.
Time starts now. This is easy. The boys should get this.
The time's very sad.
You can't hear me.
You've got 10 seconds. You've used your only life.
You have 5 seconds. Okay, what was the answer?
Muhammad Ali.
Okay, yep, that
the
was correct.
The answer is Muhammad Ali, correct.
Muhammad Ali.
1 point
for Aston. Please be, keep quiet when the sound clips are going on, otherwise it's not fair on the contestants, please. Okay, so the next team is the University of Birmingham.
Okay. All right, so
University of Birmingham.
Can we play the next sound clip, please?
Should we feel empowered that we've been given this great opportunity to now come in a community that has the Spirit of God?
Okay, you have 30 seconds from now.
Are you sure? Shout out any answers, guys. If they're wrong or right, please don't say it.
You can't ask the audience unless you use it as your lifeline.
You have one opportunity to ask the audience.
All right, are you using the lifeline? Okay. So who do you want to ask? Okay. Okay, Afroz. Okay.
Afroz.
Okay, do you want to accept that, Hussain Rajabli?
You've got like half a second.
Okay, so that was correct. It was Hussain Rajabli.
All right, that's 1 point for UOB. This is the second sound clip for University of Birmingham. For University of... can we have it, please?
Okay, can you play it now?
As a representative of Islam, I would consider myself an ambassador for Islam, a believer in Islam, a follower of Islam and its prophet.
Okay. Please don't shout out any answers.
30 seconds from now. You have 20 seconds.
Don't say anything.
If I give a correct answer, does it count?
Yes, obviously.
You sure?
If Allah you say any answer...
You have 10 seconds, so...
Allahu A'lam. Allahu A'lam.
You have 5 seconds. Can you just...
Correct answer.
All right.
What is it? What
two,
did you say?
One, stop. Sorry, you gave no answer. The correct answer was Mehdi Hassan.
Okay, so the next sound clip, please, for Coventry University.
Of giving back to the community was an age by which the Holy Prophet of Islam demonstrated proactiveness.
Oh, okay.
All right, guys, let's Coventry, not shout any answers out, please.
You have 30 seconds from now.
You have 30 seconds. You can ask the audience if you don't know it, unless you've got about 20 seconds left. Think wisely, think hard.
You have 15 seconds. Lifeline. Okay, who do you want to ask? One of you two decide who do you want to ask.
Which one of you wants to ask the audience?
One of you have to decide who wants to pick. Does anyone know the answer? So put your
hand up. No.
Put your hand up if you know the answer. Come on, guys.
Ladies, sisters, does anyone know the answer? No? Yes?
Anyone, just choose someone from the crowd.
You've got you haven't got long once you ask someone.
Anyone who knows the answer?
No, it doesn't work like that. You have to pick one guy.
Just choose someone.
Or one sister. Either yeah, one.
That guy with his hand up. Yeah.
Can you stand up? Yeah, stand up. Go ahead.
Yeah, that's what I said.
Okay, so do you want to accept their answer?
Yeah.
Okay, so Sheikh Mohammed Al-Hili, yeah?
Yeah.
Okay, so that was the correct answer. That was the easiest one, guys. Come on.
We wanted to see if anyone would not know that. That'd be really awkward.
Okay, so the next sound clip for Coventry, please.
These things we believe in and buy into are stories that require consent, money, concept. The economy is a concept. All these things require our participation.
The time starts now. We've asked the audience, you can't use anything again. You have to give an answer. Please don't shout anything out.
You have about 10 seconds left. 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3. You can guess. 2, 1. Time's up. Didn't get it?
You've gone past your time limit now,
okay,
by the way.
Okay, so time's up. The answer was Russell Brand.
Oh, sorry. No points, sorry, for... actually, 1 point, right, for Coventry Uni.
One
but not
Coventry.
From this, from the previous question. Okay.
Okay, so next... DMU University.
UOL. Leicester.
Leicester, sorry, Leicester.
Get it right, mate.
Next, Leicester. Sound clip for Leicester, please.
And I try to describe my love for you. No liars, only words.
Time's up.
Time's up.
It's Maher Zain.
That's correct, Maher Zain.
It's 1 point for Leicester.
This is how it's meant to work. It's not that hard. Okay, next sound clip, please.
Sorry, can I just
Leicester.
Ask, is there going to be three questions?
Sorry?
This is the second question. We
yeah, for you, yeah. The second sound clip for you.
What's the next round about?
We'll go on to that.
You'll find out.
I just want to know when to use the lifeline, playing it right.
Basically, you'll find out what the next round is,
right.
But use it wisely. If you don't know it here, you can use it here. All right,
okay,
can we have
so
the sound clip, please?
The next sound clip, please.
Some people say they don't know where we stand or what we stand for. So let me take the opportunity today to spell it out in the simplest of terms.
Okay, can you
play
that
again,
please?
Play that again?
A bit louder.
Some people say they don't know where we stand or what we stand for. So let me take the opportunity today to spell it out in the simplest of terms.
Please don't say it if you know it.
It's,
I see some guys whispering.
Okay, you have...
Can we just get it one more time, please?
No, I'm
sorry,
mate.
It wasn't loud enough
work.
The first time.
All right, one more time. You had
some
it about
people say they don't know where we stand or what we stand for. So let me take the opportunity today to spell it out in the simplest of terms.
You have 15 seconds.
Yeah. It's our very esteemed brother, Ed Miliband.
That's correct. Correct.
That's another point for University of Leicester. All right, so DMU, are you ready? Can we have the sound clip for DMU, please? No one say anything, please. Your time has started. You have 15 seconds. Can we play it one more time?
Please don't shout out the answer. Play it one more time. Hold on one moment.
After this, you have 10 seconds. You have about 5 seconds left.
Sorry, I use a lifeline, please.
Lifeline?
Yeah. Lifeline, someone from the audience.
Just bear in mind, after lifeline, you have 2 seconds remaining. Shout out the answer if he hasn't picked you. All right, okay. Yeah, the answer is Abu Dhar Al Halawaji. So that's a point for DMU.
Okay. Okay. The next sound clip, please.
What we want is put the maximum effort into to be as close as possible to give ourselves a chance.
Your time started. If you know it, don't say it, please. I know a lot of people here will know it. You've used your lifeline as well. All right, play it once more, please.
what we want is put the maximum effort in to be as close as possible to give ourselves a chance.
All right, you have about 10 seconds left.
Ronaldo?
Sorry, what was your answer?
Ronaldo?
Ronaldo, Cristiano Ronaldo, or Fat Ronaldo. The answer is incorrect. I'm sorry. It's Arsene Wenger, the manager of Arsenal Football Club. My dad's over there, he's smiling. Okay, salawat ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala wa ali Muhammad.
Right, so that's the end of round two. Can our kind assistant, Sister Safiya, tally up the scores for us, please? The University of Leicester's on top. Tie. Everyone else? Really? No halves? So Leicester has how many? Two? No, all together. No, all together has to, from the previous round as well. Okay, while she's counting up. Hussein?
Yep.
Did you enjoy the food?
Did I enjoy the?
In the food?
The food, yes,
I did. Are you waiting for gulab jamun?
Yes, definitely, and ice cream, I believe. I can't wait for the ice cream. I like ice cream.
Yeah. To be honest,
don't lie. I hope they've saved some for us then.
I think University of Leicester, they performed quite well in this round, right? You guys. Are you happy with your performance? You're going to walk away with the silverware. What happened to Aston, man?
Yeah, come on.
Nah, Muhammad Ali, bro. We can't even
hear it. Muhammad Ali, float like a butterfly, sing like a bee. That's easy. Everyone knows that. Come on.
If you can hear it, then it's easy, isn't it?
Right, have we got the final scores from both rounds?
It was the same.
I reckon Aston will somehow still be on top. Modges are. Right, that's University of Leicester on top with 2.5 points. Shortly followed by University of Birmingham with 2 points.
Whoop, whoop.
Right, it's close, very close. Coventry University, third place with 1.5 points so far. Aston University and DMU tied with 1 point.
Well done, guys. Okay, so I knew, like we said, the last sound clip was Arsene Wenger. So as an Arsenal fan, I got that straight away.
Me and Sheikh Hilly are Liverpool fans. So we expected Steven Gerrard. Yeah, you know about that. So next time, inshallah.
So Sheikh, how did you find hearing your own voice clip? Did you get it straight away or not? You were going to call a friend? Okay, so I hope you all enjoyed that round. It was slightly different. We did try and use the sound system. Unfortunately, it was a bit fuzzy, but I hope you all enjoyed it. And now you guys need to put in all your efforts for the last and final round to get into the eliminator stage.
Yes, that's right. And our last third final round, a chance for you guys to make it to the final, Champions League final. It's called Complete the Hadith. So what's going to happen is each pair will be given half a hadith from myself and Hussein, and you have to complete it. It's quite obvious, it's the last round. If you've not used a lifeline, now's your chance to use it. I think everyone might have. However, if you haven't used it, make sure you use it.
I think everyone has.
Sorry?
I think everyone's used their lifeline.
Okay, cool. You haven't used it? Leicester hasn't used it.
No.
Okay, cool. Be smart, be wise with your lifeline. Well, you can't, yeah. And good luck. All right,
okay.
Let's start round three. Start with this side.
Yeah, you can start.
We'll start with this side. Right, round three, question one. Your time starts after. Hussein, can you time it? Your time starts after I repeat the question. Say the question. Question one: the best among you are those who have your time started. A hadith from the Holy Prophet Muhammad.
Taqwa.
So the best among you are those who have taqwa.
Yeah.
Final answer.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, that's incorrect. The correct answer is the best among you are those who have the best manners and character, a hadith from our Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. Okay, so the next question is for Lester. It's a quote by Imam Ali. So it goes, be like the flower, dot, dot, dot.
The time started.
Be like the flower that gives fragrance to the hand, even to the hand that crushes it.
Final answer?
Okay. Final answer.
Right.
Okay, that was correct. Well done, Lester Absock.
Lester are doing well, aren't they? Well done, Lester. Okay. Coventry University. A hadith from the Holy Prophet Muhammad again. Cleanliness is... Your time starts now. What is cleanliness? You don't get points.
You have 15 seconds left.
Cleanliness is...
Virtue.
Cleanliness is virtue. Unfortunately, that's incorrect. The correct answer from the Holy Prophet Muhammad, he says, cleanliness is a part of faith. Can we have a salawat for that, please? Unlucky comment.
Okay, so the next question is for UOB. It is a quote by Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad. And it says, the most blessed marriage is...
Time has started.
The most blessed marriage is... Dot, dot, dot. We have 15 seconds remaining.
Have you used your lifeline?
Yeah, they have.
By the way, Lester, you can't use your lifeline in the wildfire.
No. Okay, unfortunately, that was correct. The least expenses.
So no bling bling.
Okay, and the last question for Aston University.
Come on, Aston. Keep asking us, inshallah. Questions depend on your timer starting. Actions depend. Don't say it out loud. Everyone knows it. More people say it when I say don't say it.
You have 15 seconds.
Actions depend on it.
Ahsan! Salam! Well done, Ahsan. Well
okay.
done, guys.
Well done, guys.
Can we shout for all teams?
Allahumma salli ala. Okay, so well done to everyone. That's the end of the third and final initial rounds. It was nice to have you all participate, and we really appreciate the time you took to come up on stage and go through these tough questions. But unfortunately, the way it works is that three of you will not be here, so... And two can only proceed on further. So, could Sister Sophia please count up the scores and let us know?
Sister Sophia.
Fifth place, please.
Fifth place.
From fifth place, please.
Three of you will be fired. Fifth place, DMU. Can we have a salawat for DMU?
Do you want to head back to Muhammad.
Well done, DMU. Right, in fourth place, Coventry
fourth
University.
Place, yeah, Coventry.
Well done.
Well done. Could you please go take a seat? Thank you very much for taking part.
Thank you. Oh, come on, Aston. Come on, Aston.
Okay. Okay, in third place, who do we have? There's a tie. Okay, so there is a tie between Aston and University of Birmingham.
How ironic. Aston and UOB. Who are we supporting?
Okay.
All right, guys. Okay, we actually expected something like this would happen.
Yeah, we prepared for this.
So I've got two questions for each team. You have to answer them as soon as you can because we're running very short of time. You have to answer these two questions I have for you in a very short amount of time. You have no lifelines, and you have 30 seconds, to answer each. Okay, so for University of Birmingham, how many times is Ya Allah mentioned in Surah Rahman? The time starts now. How many times is Tabi Ya Allah mentioned Surah Rahman?
32.
Your final answer is 32? That's incorrect. It's actually 31. Unlucky. Second question.
Very unlucky.
For UOB.
Second question.
So that's 0 points so far for UOB. Unlucky. Name three mosques mentioned in the Holy Quran. So time starts now.
It's for us.
Yes, it's for you.
It's for us.
You have not much time remaining. You have how much time remaining?
You have 10 seconds remaining. What? Last one.
Go for it. Just
5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Unlucky.
Do you have one?
So the answers were that were given. Masjid al-Haram and Masjid al-Aqsa are mentioned in the Holy Quran. That's half a point because unfortunately you didn't get a third. The other ones are Masjid al-Qubba, Masjid al-Nabawi, and Masjid al-Zarar. So that's half a point from UOB of
half
a possible
point for UOB.
Two? Yeah. Okay, very quickly, Asanini, we're on a time limit. Okay, question three.
Two questions.
What is, each question is worth 1 point. Yeah? What is the meaning of the word Quran? Your time starts now. Quran, normal, the Holy Quran. What does Quran mean? Tougher than it sounds. Time's running out. I want to give a hint to Aston.
You have 10 seconds remaining.
Again, another guess is the Book of Guidance.
Okay.
Nope, unfortunately, that's not correct.
Quran
means that which is read.
Okay.
Aston Uni, no point, sorry there. Okay, after the wreckage of Prophet Nuh's ark, where is the resting place according to the Holy Quran? After the ark of Prophet Nuh? It's a resting place. They went to a specific place to rest after the ark broke.
You have 15 seconds remaining.
We think it's the mountain near Palestine.
Right, I don't know where this place is located, but I'm not that good at geography. But the answer is, according to the Holy Quran, it's the Cave of Judi. Is the final answer. Well,
so
it's the correct answer.
Unfortunately, no points there.
Sorry, Aston.
Aston.
God takes away the ones you love.
So from the sounds of it, it looks
Inna
like
lillahi.
Aston. Bye-bye. Okay, sorry. Bye. All
right, we need to get through this very quickly. What's going to happen for the final round? It's down to University of Leicester and University of Birmingham. What's going to happen is we're going to ask you as many questions as you can answer in 60 seconds. So keep your mics by your face. Get ready. You can pass. You can skip a question. You can't use a lifeline. Answer as many as you can. You have 60 seconds. Then we're going to add up the final scores. And whichever from this round alone, answers the most questions correctly will win the Absoc Awards. Okay, are we ready?
Okay, so it's Leicester first.
Yep.
Okay, so I'll ask the questions to Leicester, okay? Okay, so you have 60 seconds after I ask the first question, okay? Loads of questions in 60 seconds.
You have to answer as many as you can.
And you have to answer as many as you can in 60 seconds.
And you're going to take our first answer only.
Yes, first answer only. Okay. And you can pass if you don't know it.
Is it pass to them?
No, it's just pass as in you
can
pass
skip,
the question.
Can we come
just
back skip the question?
Skip. Pass.
Can we come back to it after
all right,
we pass?
All right, let's get started.
No. All right.
Okay.
We're running out of time.
All right. So the first question is, which planet is closest to the sun? Starting now.
Mercury.
Correct. Who is the leader of the Conservative Party?
David Cameron.
Correct. What is the meaning of Muhammad?
The one who is praised. The one who is praised.
Okay, I'll give you half a mark. Okay, praiseworthy. Found in Irish and Indian flag, what is the most sacred color in Hinduism?
Green. No.
Incorrect. It's orange. The M20 runs through which county?
Time's running out.
Pass.
Okay. Name two uncles of the Prophet Muhammad.
Hazrat Abu Talib and Abu Lahab.
Correct. What is the capital of Belgium?
Brussels.
Don't say the answer. What is 15 plus 5 times by 4?
80.
Correct. Who was the foster mum of the Holy Prophet?
Bibi Fatima bint Asad.
Incorrect. Halima Sadi.
No. She was the wet nurse, but she wasn't the foster mother.
Keep going, and we'll ask Sheikh Hilly.
Okay, Maryam's father has five daughters named Nana, Nini, Nene, and Nono. Maryam. Who's the fifth daughter?
Maryam.
Correct.
Time?
What is the capital of Turkey?
Ankara.
Okay, Ankara. Time's up.
Last question, right? Ankara.
Okay, that's
correct. That's a point. Okay, well done, University of Leicester. Can we have a salawat? Oh yeah, Sheikh Hilly, if you don't mind answering the question. What was the question? Who was the foster mother of the Holy Prophet Muhammad? Okay, so Bibi Halima, yeah? Okay, so unfortunately that's incorrect. Oh, correct. No, but they said Bibi Fatima bint Asad. No?
Wasn't.
Okay. Sorry, Leicester.
So I was correct.
I don't know.
I'm sorry, it's incorrect. We have the correct answer here.
Sorry, guys. You did well. You got to the 10th question. Or 11th question. Rather.
Okay.
All right, University of Birmingham. We need to get through this, guys.
Have you been keeping the scores, yes? Okay.
All right, University of Birmingham. Your time
Be ready.
Starts now. What is an ice hockey puck made from?
Metal. Plastic.
Incorrect.
It's rubber. How old and where did the Holy Prophet receive his first revelation?
40 years.
In
the cave of
Hussein.
Next.
Okay, correct. World Heritage Site Petra is located
where?
Jordan. Which desert covers much of Botswana and parts of Namibia?
Pass.
Okay. What does Khatam al-Nabiyyin mean?
And the last prophet.
The end of Khatam means ring, actually. But yeah, like the last one. The end.
Incorrect. It's the seal of the prophets.
Yes, okay. Ring.
No, sorry. Capital of Madagascar is?
It has no capital.
Sorry? Pass? Yeah. Okay. Which flag in the world is not rectangular? It's time.
Nepal,
okay. 17 minus 2 multiplied by 3 is?
45.
Keep going.
Okay, and what age did the Holy Prophet get married?
38.
The answer is 25.
10 seconds remain.
Okay.
Imam Musa al-Kazim.
How old was Imam Ali at Dawat al-Ashira?
12.
Time.
Okay. So, the last question count?
Yes.
Can you give it to them?
Yeah. It counts.
Was it in time or before time?
Yeah, no, because I answered.
What was the answer you gave? 12. 10. I thought it was 10 or 13. 12. Sheikh Hilly. 12, yeah? Okay, can we give one extra point to University of Leicester for the answer they gave for Bibi Fatima bint Asad? And well done, guys. We need to really, really rush. Okay, so well done to both universities. That was quite intense, actually. I make up the last two questions because I ran out, so well done. Okay. So, what's going to happen now is Sister Safiya is going to tally up. So before we give the final answers, can I ask Sheikh Muhammad Al-Hilli and Sister Afroz Zaidi to come to the stage to kindly award the trophies and medals to the winning team, please? Salawat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Sister Afroz, is she anywhere to be seen? Oh, hello. Okay.
Are we nearly there with the scores? Yeah? Got them? Okay. So, can we hear the winner, please? So, okay, so...
Wait. What about the drum roll? Can we have a drum roll?
Okay, drum roll.
The winner of Absoc Milad 2015 is Leicester Uni. Well done, well done. Can we have trophies out to them, the medals? They're over there.
Okay.
Sorry. Well done, Leicester. Well done, Birmingham as well. Better than I expected. I'm joking. Unfortunately, Aston didn't perform as usual.
For the winners.
Well done, guys.
Congratulations, Leicester. Well done.
And we have something else, don't we, for Leicester? That thing we're saying by the stage, at the bottom, by the stage, by the laptop.
Sorry?
The hamper. Is
the hamper, okay,
yes.
Sorry.
Yes. So well done, University of Birmingham. Well done to University of Leicester as well. This hamper is given by Sweetie Heaven at the back. Please do check them out. Thank you, and this is for the winning team, University of Leicester. Salawat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.
Baraye tajil zuhur imam zama bulantar salawat. Can we have one loud salawat ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad? One more loud salawat, please. Zameen maili nahi hoti, zaman maila nahi hota. Zameen maili nahi hoti, zaman maila nahi hota. Zameen maili nahi hoti, zaman maila nahi hota. Muhammad ke ghulamon ka kafan maila nahi hota. Muhammad ke ghulamon ka kafan maila nahi hota. Milke padhe. Zameen maili nahi hoti, zaman maila nahi hota. Nabi ka damane rehmat pakad lo ae jahan walo. Nabi ka damane rehmat pakad lo ae jahan walo. Rahe jab tak ye haathon mein chalan maila nahi hota. Rahe jab tak ye haathon mein chalan maila nahi hota. Aur jo naam-e Mustafa chume nahi dukhti kabhi aankhein. Jo naam-e Mustafa
Mustafa chume nahi dukhti kabhi aankhein pehen le pyar jo unka badan maila nahi hota pehen le pyar jo unka badan maila nahi hota ali qazi عبادت ہے عبادت ہے علی کا ذکر کرنا تو عبادت ہے عبادت ہے عبادت ہے عبادت ہے یہ جس من میں سما جائے وہ من میلا نہیں ہوتا حیدری یہ جس من میں علی 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 مل کے علی علی
جیو ماشاءاللہ
علی 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 علی
ماشاءاللہ
وہ من میلا نہیں ہوتا محمد کے غلاموں کا کفن میلا نہیں ہوتا
بر محمد وآل محمد صلوات
جو بت پرستوں کو دی کا کلمہ پڑھا رہا ہے وہ مصطفیٰ ہے جو بت قدوں کو خدا کا کعبہ بنا رہا وہ مصطفیٰ ہے وہ مصطفیٰ ہے وہ مصطفیٰ ہے کہیں شہِ مشرقین بن کر کہیں حسن اور حسین بن کر کہیں شہ مشرقین بن کر کہیں حسن اور حسین بن کر جو پانچ چہروں میں اپنا جلوہ دکھا رہا ہے وہ مصطفیٰ ہے وہ مصطفیٰ ہے وہ مصطفیٰ ہے
مل کے پڑھے
وہ مصطفیٰ ہے وہ مصطفیٰ ہے سلام سچے صحابیوں پر سلام ہو بوترابیوں پر عرب کے ذروں کو جو ابو ذر بنا رہا ہے وہ مصطفیٰ ہے
wo Mustafa hai, wo Mustafa hai, aur batul ko mezba bana kar Ali o Hasnain ko bula kar jo yun hadise qissa ki mehfil saja raha hai wo Mustafa 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 hai
bar Muhammad wa al Muhammad salawat
lagate hai dari nare hai chehre muskurate hain lagate hai dari nare hai chehre muskurate hain lagate hai dari nare hai chehre muskurate hain Ali ke chahne wale khushi aise manate hain Ali ke chahne wale khushi aise manate hain Nabi ke chahne wale khushi aise manate hain Hamari bandagi maula hamari zindagi maula Nabi ne keh diya maula jise bas hai wahi maula sikhaya maan apni sikhaya maan apni loriyon mein ya ali maula ghadir e khum ka qissa apne bachchon ko sunate hain ali ke chahne wale khushi aise Haydari Zamana dar par dekhe zara misam ki darai banaya dar ko minbar mili mera je goyai ali ka kaal sacha ho gaya hai ye khushi pai zuban jab kaati jati hai to misam muskurate hain Ali ke chahne wale khushi aise
Ali Maula MashaAllah Ali 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 Ya Ali
Khula karta hai haj ke dar mein khushiyon ka darwaza tawaf aisa hai hota jhoomta hai khanae kaaba dilon mein azmat e tauheed lab par ya Ali maula khuda ke ghar Ali paida hue sabko batate hain Haydari Ali ke cha
Haydar 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 MashaAllah
Ali ke chahne wale khushi aise manate hain jo kehlata hai momin karbala ka hai wo bashinda mazalim ke muqabil khoon se rehta hai painda ali par jaan dekar ye hamesha ho gaye zinda علی پر جان دے کر یہ ہمیشہ ہو گئے زندہ علی پر جان دے کر یہ ہمیشہ ہو گئے زندہ شہیدوں کے تو چہرے بھی کفن میں مسکراتے ہیں علی کے چاہنے والے خوشی ایسے مناتے ہیں زندہ باد ولا والے یہاں پر ہیں ولی کا ذکر لازم ہے خدا والے یہاں پر ہیں نبی کا ذکر لازم ہے علی والے یہاں پر ہیں علی کا ذکر لازم ہے کوئی میلاد کرتے ہیں کوئی میلاد کرتے ہیں کوئی محفل سجاتے ہیں علی کے چاہنے والے خوشی ایسے مناتے ہیں لگاتے ہیں دری نعرے ہیں چہرے مسکراتے ہیں
بر محمد وال محمد بلند تر صلوات
Thank you very much for that beautiful recitation. And as you know, time is running out and we'd like Sister Afroz Zaidi to come and give her speech on her topic tonight. Salawat ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad.
Assalamu alaikum, my dear sisters and brothers. Thank you very much to those of you who are still here. I know that it's a painfully late time in the night. If we can begin with a loud salawat for Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. And my congratulations to everyone here on the birth of the Blessed Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. Who is a mercy for all of mankind. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. So we're here to discuss the Prophet as reformer, and I'm not going to take too much of your time because I know that we're running short. So I will try to make this quick. But when we think about the Prophet as reformer, a question to anyone who would like to answer it. What did the Prophet reform? And I know that Sheikh Hilly touched upon this earlier in his lecture, but does anyone have any thoughts on the things that the Prophet reformed when he came in, when he assumed prophethood, when he sort of assumed his role? Are there any suggestions? Clearly too late in the evening for anyone to offer any suggestions. So obviously one of the things was the rights of women. We know that female infants were being buried at the time of the Prophet, and he came and put a stop to that. And various other things that were put in place in terms of laws to make things more equal for women and to make things more fair for women. Following the advent of Islam, and also putting an end to the tribalism and the racism that was rampant in what is now Saudi Arabia, but in that area of Arabia at the time. So those were kind of two of the key things that, you know, among many that the Prophet reformed. And really, the root, I think, of both of them is the concept of justice. And this is something that is really quite deeply embedded in Islam, I think, more so than we realize. So the Prophet in Surah Ash-Shura, verse 15, the Prophet, this is the Prophet actually saying, I'm commanded to do justice among you. So Allah says to the Prophet, say that I am commanded to do justice among you. And then obviously we know the verse that's by now famous because of being on the library of the Harvard Law, on the wall of the library of the Harvard Law School. O you who believe, stand out firmly for justice as witnesses to Allah, though it may be against your own selves or your parents or near relatives, and whether it be against rich or poor, for Allah can best protect you both, which is An-Nisa verse 135. And this is, I mean, these are only a couple of the verses that in which there are several others very throughout the Quran in which really there's this real emphasis on establishing justice, not just, you know, the verse just here. It doesn't just say to be just, but it says to stand out firmly for justice. It says to, another verse says, say, O Muhammad, my Lord has commanded justice, and that you should face him only in each and every place of worship in prayers, and invoke him only. So justice is listed alongside a tenet as key as Tawheed. So clearly it's not one of those kind of arbitrary, you know, yes, it's nice to have it, but really one of the key founding beliefs in Islam. And this is what the Prophet really brought to us when we think of him as reformer. So another one, another verse in which I think is quite relevant to the way we, I suppose, conduct ourselves, or the way we should conduct ourselves. This is Surah An-Nahl, verse 76, in which the Quran says, Allah puts forward an example of two men, one of them dumb, who has no power over anything, and he is a burden to his master, whichever way he directs him. He brings no good. Is such a man equal to one who commands justice and is himself on the straight path? So really, it's a question of the person, the believer, the one who is on the straight path, being the person who commands justice. So it's, again, the idea of a believer having justice and somebody who commands justice as that being an integral part of our faith as believers. And conversely, also, there's the example that we need to be aware of that we don't become the dumb, dumb not just in the intellectual sense, but also in the verbal sense, in the sense of, you know, are we speaking? Are we actually using our mind, and are we speaking our mind, or are we just kind of sheep following along with the crowds and with whatever is popular? So coming back to the Prophet as reformer, and if we look at actually our society today, I think it's fair to say that it's probably much worse off in terms of the temptations, in terms of the evils that are present in this day and age than at the time of the Prophet, peace be upon him and his progeny. Yet are we really doing enough to actually really establish this message of justice and of reformation that the Prophet left behind? I think it's a question that we need to ask ourselves. So it's not just about singing the Prophet's praises and, you know, organizing nice Milad dinners, but also about, which are very nice, by the way, especially the food and the company, but it's also more so, it's about actually living the legacy of the Prophet as reformer, and doing so by establishing the justice that is required of all believers. And we do this by, obviously, there are internal issues that need to be tackled within our own communities, and there are external issues. So not just looking at the things that, the oppressions that we face, but also looking beyond that at what different various forms of oppression are faced by other groups in humanity. And in terms of internal issues, I think we again go back to the two things that, sort of most prominent things that come to mind when we think of the Reformation of the Prophet, which is the rights of women and racism and tribalism. which still remain rampant actually internally in our communities. And we have, you know, we actually have people quoting verses from the Quran saying, oh, we created you in tribes, and that means that you can go along and be your own tribe, and that's okay, and Allah is okay with that. But actually, when it comes to this whole thing of favoring your own kind, or actually what's known as asabiya in Arabic, of is what is really what manifests as a prejudice towards or a favoring of your own people. And there is a hadith of Imam Hussain alayhi wasalam, when asked about asabiya, he replied that it makes a person sinful. In that he takes if he takes the worst actions of his nation or tribe to be better than the best actions of the opponent tribe. It is not asabiya to love one's nation. However, if one helps his nation in committing oppression, that is asabiya. And oppression is what? Oppression is excluding people who may want to be part of your community. Oppression is, you know, hurting the feelings of people because they are a different ethnicity to you. But we don't really think about these things when we go about our general dealings in the community. We're quite happy to be in our own bubble and just go along without actually questioning the things that have been embedded in our communities. And similarly with women, with the rights of women. Sadly, so many mosques don't have voting rights for women. They don't have equal opportunities for membership for women. And rather than everybody working to facilitate, actively work to facilitate more proportionate representation of women in their mosques, they're quite passive about it. You know, the brothers particularly, I suppose it's an issue that doesn't affect you, so you're quite happy to look the other way. But really, that's not, if we are looking to live the legacy of the Prophet, and to actually follow in the footsteps of the Prophet, then the Prophet would not have been passive about this situation. And if we are actually claiming to follow in the footsteps of the Prophet, then the thing to do is to actively question why women are not being proportionately represented and to actively work to change that. And then externally as well, outside our own community, there are so many things, there are so many issues that need dealing with, but we seem to have fallen into kind of these comfortable areas where we're quite happy to be active, and then beyond that, nobody really thinks that there are any other issues. So we talk, so Who's Hussein is they are a great initiative, but again, it's one of those safe things that people are quite happy to volunteer for that. Interfaith work, Al-Quds Day, Shia genocide, and fundraising. We like to do a lot of charity and fundraising work. But outside of these things that I can kind of count on one hand, there aren't that many issues that people actively get involved in, even though, there's a Ferguson Solidarity Tour going on around the UK, and they were in Birmingham just last Wednesday, but I wonder how many people actually present here attended that. Even though the events in Ferguson are relevant to us as Muslims, because we believe, and we strongly oppose the oppression of people based on their race. Similarly, other issues that we seem to be comfortable in these few kind of safe arenas, and don't look beyond that. We don't look beyond the interfaith work. We don't really look beyond the fundraising. And yes, that all needs to be done, but also we need to kind of not be complacent and think that that's enough. And we need to look beyond that to see what else can be done. Are our ABSOCs really doing enough to go beyond these issues, to address issues beyond our own immediate Shia community? And I think the answer, probably we all know, is that they aren't. And it's not just ABSOCs. I think it's generally Shia youth, Shia communities in general. We are complacent. We are complacent in our own kind of issues, in our own bubble. And we don't really think it's worthwhile to go beyond that. Even though there are so many worthy issues, that deserve to be addressed and that actually are our duty to address if we are truly to establish and to uphold justice and to be committed to justice. When I think about the Prophet as a reformer, I think actually that's not really a fair statement. I mean, Sheikh Hilly previously compared, talked about how he was sort of far beyond kind of the people that are currently in popular history held as reformers, such as Martin Luther and so on. But I don't actually think that the word reformer is a fair description. I think the Prophet was a revolutionary. He shook up the status quo. He challenged established practices and ways of thinking. And that's what we need to be. If we want to be following in the footsteps of the Prophet truly, we need to be revolutionaries. And I'll end there. Thank you very much for listening. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sister. These are words of truth, these are words of wisdom, and this is our Prophet. But now it's time to announce the winner of tonight's SafeerTV raffle. Are you ready? The person who is about to win for a beautiful prize from Najaf al-Ashraf, from the Shrine of Imam Ali. I will now announce it. I hope that person is here. Salawat ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. The number's in my pocket. And the winner is raffle number 112. Who is that person? Raffle number 112. You have won a carpet from the Shrine of Imam Ali alayhi salam. Are you here? You have 10 seconds to announce yourself. 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. The next person to win this is number 91. Number 91, are you here? Number 91, are you here? Oh, okay, number 91 is here. Oh, it's not, oh. Yeah. Number 91, you're a lucky winner. Salawat ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. This is a prize truly worth winning. Well done. And the next raffle is for the beautiful painting of the word that represents God in Arabic, and that is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this beautiful painting was drawn by an upcoming artist from Leicester. As you can see, the intricate design on this picture, the calligraphy is unmatchable, and this prize will be won by someone in this room tonight, and they will be going home with it tonight. Salawat ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. The lucky winner tonight is number 35. Are you here? Number 35. Are you here? 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Number 44. Are you here? Number 44. Is it you? No, okay, it's not you. Is she here? Number 44, come collect your prize with a loud salawat. Ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. Well done. It's not really like a competition, but congratulations for your present. Next up tonight is our final nasheed. A nasheed that will help us smell the smell of the Prophet and his favorite scent, musk. I invite Sayyid Ali al-Hakim to the stage with a loud salawat ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad.
Please recite a Fatiha for Umm al-Baneen. صلى على محمد وآل محمد. for the love of Imam al-Hassan and Imam al-Hussein. A second salawat. For the love of Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali, a third in the loudest of your voices. How can I speak of this man, humble and speech and honorable and physique? If I start with his smile, my mind is enchanted, and in my awe I cannot speak. His smile that shines so bright illuminates the earth and skies, for heaven from this smile is created, and from the universe in this smile resides. For if this smile turned into a frown, what calamity? Oh, what a smile! What a smile that brings the world balance, and gives the searching heart hope, and gives a home to the orphan. What a smile! What a smile that brings down tyrants and sends his message loud and clear. For his smile is the charity he'd given, and no charity is a waste. Salawat. Assalamu alaikum, dear brothers and sisters. I know it's very late and there's, you know, most of the people have gone, but the minority that are left here, let's try and create the best atmosphere of the day, inshallah. The first poem's chorus will be, Oh the Prophet Muhammad, Oh the Prophet. Very simple, Oh the Prophet Muhammad, Oh the Prophet. Now this will involve clapping, so if you can all participate in clapping with my hand, that would be much appreciated. Jazakumullah khaira jaza, salla ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
Oh the Prophet Muhammad, Oh the Prophet, Oh the Prophet Muhammad, Oh the Prophet. Your voices. Oh the Prophet Muhammad, Oh the Prophet. A bit louder, mashallah. Oh the Prophet Muhammad, Oh the Prophet. You're like the drop of water falling onto the dry ground, and an oasis is now made, and the cracked ground does now fade. The water pools around us, and it nourishes the land. Now it's a place of beauty, that's which was before dry sand. The miracle, Muhammad, the miracle. Oh, the Prophet, Oh, the Prophet, Muhammad. Oh the Prophet, louder mashallah. Oh the Prophet Muhammad. And from this spot of water a flower begins to grow, reaching for the clouds above, and its petals white as snow. The flower is Fatima, sprouting for all of the sky. She's the pride of Muhammad, and the joy within his eyes. A great father, Muhammad, a great father. Oh, the Prophet, Oh, the Prophet, Muhammad, Oh, the Prophet. Mashallah, Oh the Prophet Muhammad, Oh the and I pledge on this day I will follow you till my death. You take me to new heights, and I will never forget your family that you sent, and to the world I'll present. They'll hear my voice and they will hear the praises that I sing. They'll call your name Muhammad, they'll call your name. Oh the Prophet, Oh the Prophet Muhammad, Oh the Prophet. MashaAllah, oh the Prophet Muhammad, oh the Prophet, perfect in every way and chosen by God the Most Great to bring down the message and inspire every state. You mesmerize my brain and I'll never comprehend your beauty and your knowledge, for it does never end. I'll call your name Muhammad, I'll call yon, oh the Prophet, oh the Prophet Muhammad, oh the Prophet, MashaAllah, oh the Prophet Muhammad. What's this world without a smile? What's this world without a smile and a tongue that speaks the truth? He grew from the desert a rose, and with morals arose, taught the people the value of their daughters, and to be kind to the slave and orphan, and visit the ill-stricken, give charity even if it's a smile. He's a man unlike any other. He's the truthful, he's the trustworthy, he's the knowledgeable, and he's the savior of humanity. None other than Muhammad, salawat.
Fantastic participation. Let's try and up it a bit more now. This one's a bit faster, and the pace of the clapping will alternate. It's very simple. Habibi Ahmed four times. Habibi is an Arabic word which means my love, so we're saying my love Ahmed, but we're going to say Habibi Ahmed four times. The place will alternate, so please stay with my hand. Jazakumullah khair jazak. Salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
Habibi Ahmed, 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 Habibi Ahmed. He was Ahmed, peace be on him. He was abused from limb to limb. His face is the shine of the sun. He's the leader of everyone. His name I will chant and sing. Habibi Ahmed, Habibi Ahmed, Habibi Ahmed, Habibi Ahmed, Habibi Ahmed, hello, Habibi Ahmed, Habibi Ahmed, Habibi Ahmed, Habibi. Grant a visit to Medina, from Samarra to Karbala, days of Milad to Ashura. I want to see him, inshallah. I pray for that. Oh, Allah. Habibi Ahmed, Habibi Ahmed, Habibi Ahmed, Habibi Ahmed, Habibi. Louder, hello. Habibi Ahmed, Habibi Ahmed, Habibi Ahmed, Habibi. For every step I have taken, the name of Islam has shaken. For I am a sinner broken. Muhammad made my mind open. Only his name be spoken. Habibi Ahmed, Habibi Ahmed, Habibi Ahmed, Habibi Ahmed, Habibi. Louder, hello. Habibi Ahmed, Habibi Ahmed, Habibi Ahmed, Habibi. He achieved miracles in life, taught the way of peace, not knife. To be like him, I always strive. My role models him and the five. For their names, my heart revives. Habibi Ahmed, Habibi Ahmed, Habibi Ahmed, Habibi Ahmed, Habibi. Mashallah. Allah, Habibi Ahmed, Habibi Ahmed, Habibi Ahmed, Habibi. Given the pure name Mustafa, and became father of Fatima, grandfather of my Tharallah, his love for the grand Wajhullah, and his sight son Mujtaba. Habibi Ahmed, 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 Habibi. habibi, Ahmed habibi. Ah, when asked who's this man I draw, that he elevated my mind to great statuses, I reply with a rose I draw, a man unlike any other. Oh, this man is the king of kings, Muhammad salawat.
Last final poem, inshallah. Ahmed six times. The fifth Ahmed will be longer than the rest. So it's Ahmed six times. It's the fast, this is the fastest poem in the night, inshallah. And the clapping will alternate again. Jazakumullah khair. Jazak. Salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
Ahmed, 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 hala, hala, Ahmed, 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 Ahmed. Ah, he is the king, his love unseen, grandpa, the of Hussein. He is Ahmed, my love and life, the cure to all my pain. His legacy will dominate and will drive me insane. His legacy will dominate and will drive me insane. Ahmed, 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 louder. Ahmed, 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 Muhammad, the rose of my life, the sunshine of Haydar. His love will mean separation, the shield from all danger. I am now in desperation, his love, I'm no stranger. I am now in desperation, his love, I'm no stranger. Ahmed, 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 mashallah. Ahmed, 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 ah, I'm a lover, a Husseini, we are all Haydari. My salah is for my Allah, and I pray for Ali. My patience is from Askari, we await the Mahdi. My patience is from Askari, we await the Mahdi. Ahmed, 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 louder. Ahmed, 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 ah, he did conquer all the evil and with such piety and with, mashallah, from the depths of what seemed like hell brought up humanity. His life is a great fairy tale, achieve equality. His life is a great fairy tale, achieve equality. Ahmed, 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 hala, Ahmed, 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 Muhammad, 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 hello, Muhammad, 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 Sautu Ali, Quran, Muhammad, Nabi al-Ajan, Sautu Ali, Quran, Muhammad, Nabi al-Ajan, wa Fatima al-Hasanan, wa Fatima والحسنان كلهم في كربلاء. محمد, 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 محمد. يم صلي, صلي على النبي وصلي على العترة, صلي على علي وحسن وحسين والزهرة. His name in the heavens is Ahmed, and behold the heavens were created, and on earth is Muhammad, and behold the guide of creation. Yes, I've drawn with this rose Muhammad, and my smile reflects Muhammad, and my actions are those of Muhammad. Everything began with Muhammad, and everything will end with Muhammad. And to be blessed in this world and the next, send your peace and blessings upon Muhammad wa ali Muhammad, salawat.
To the poets in order, the first poem, Sadiq Damani, second and third poem, Sayyid Wathiq Abdi, and to the freestyle poet, Tayyib Sa'adun from Michigan. So please thank them all with the loudest of your salats ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Sayyid Hakim. And tonight, this is the final thing I'm going to say. Thank you for coming, and thank you for being here, and thank you for celebrating Milad al-Nabi with me and with all of us from Ahlul Bayt Society. Salawat ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. Thank you to our sponsors. Please visit the stalls at the back. Thank you. Thank you all. Ma'a salam.